going to, excuse me while I get situated in the very tiny space where I can record. We are going to talk about modern psychoanalysis. I cutesily call this unit the post-Freud unit. It's chapter 11 in the book. Can we go to the next slide? Here we go. Yeah, because last kind of chunk of Freudiness was chapter 10, where I went over the basics of psychoanalysis, kind of covered the stuff that most folks don't cover. I gave you some justification of why, as a pragmatic person, Freud is actually useful. And now we'll talk about stuff that's actually being used in present day. All right, I kind of already just did this, but I'm gonna do it again for the camera. So in terms of objectives, we will discuss how Freud's theory has been reinterpreted and altered by the Neo-Freudians. We'll discuss some important elements of several Neo-Freudian theories. I have trimmed these down a little. There are some that I don't cover here that I think are still important, so I encourage you to check them out in the book, like object relations theory, etc. We'll also discuss current research on attachment theory. I will send you to a couple of videos that I think are really nice and illustrative. So there will be some like non-Mason content here, but it will be cat themed, so you'll get that Mason spirit. And lastly, I'll discuss some of the identifications, the propositions of psychoanalytic theory that have been empirically supported. Cool. So, developments in psychoanalysis. Many people are still trying to prove Freud wrong. It's almost like a pastime. It feels almost cheating at this point. But it's been massively refined, the thinking behind psychoanalysis, by both clinical practitioners as well as theorists. Some of these minor refinements in theory are there to make it make sense in the current context. Others are way more drastic, like less emphasis on sexual and aggressive instincts, more focus on the interpersonal aspects, concerned with early attachments. So there's a rapid shift from like sex to relationships. It's the cleanest, simplest way to explain it. So interpreting Freud just in general can be tough. You'll notice in the last module, I discussed how the definition of energy changed, and using the term libido, like its lay uses now are like sexual interest, while previously it was all about like just general energy. And so these terms have been kind of reused and reimagined, and so it can be a little challenging to keep everything in one nice holistic thing, just because the original theory is more than 100 years old. It needed a makeover. Also, Freud changed his mind on important issues more than once, which is totally okay. Like, it's good to refine theory, but that also, the downside is it's a little hard to pinpoint that. And I've already kind of hinted at this with the libido piece, like reinterpreting libido as life drive rather than like these floating energy things. And just developments that include the changing tasks of the social world. Like, women can vote and drive and own land. It's revolutionary. And so Freudian theory has to kind of be updated to reflect that. So basic latter-day issues and theorists. So the Neo-Freudian psychology, here's the definition, folks, is a general term for a psychoanalytically oriented work of many, and this applies to many theorists and researchers who are influenced by Freud today. Anna Freud is like, so these are a couple of the big people. A couple of them will get their own slides. So Anna Freud is Freud's kinder. She focused on defense mechanisms. You've got Bruno Bettelheim, who focused more on child psychiatry and parenting. You've got Harry Stack Sullivan, who focuses on interpersonal relationships, personifications. You've got Henry Murray, the same Murray from the TAT way back in like module 3 or whatever the module is. Back in when we talked about projective tests, he focused on refining projective measures, focusing on like needs, like need for achievement, etc., etc. Now, these Neo-Freudians are mentioned, but for the most part, the book, some chunks of the book, like, doesn't provide a lot of extra info, but I just want to give you a sense of, like, these guys use the same methods as Freud, case studies, introspection, not experimentation. And in that sense, because there's not a lot of experimentation, I'm a Freudian, a Neo-Freudian. I haven't run an experiment in years. Since undergrad in a research methods class. Because my research questions don't lend themselves to experiments. Not ethically, anyway. Alright, so here's some common themes in Neo-Freudian thought. There's less emphasis on libido. Instead of, like, the sex thing, it's more about a general motivation behind life and creativity. There's less emphasis, blah, blah. Sorry, I've got like my camera here and my screen here. There's less emphasis on unconscious mental processes and more on conscious thoughts, such as like an example of this is like ego psychology, where the focus is on the processes driving the perception and conscious comprehension of reality. For example, Lovinger's believed that the ego's function was to make sense of everything a person experiences. And there's just, in general, less emphasis on those instinctual drives and mental life as a source of psychological difficulties, and more on the interpersonal relationships. So, like, we're moving away from the, like, nebulous stuff and instinct and mental and libido to, like, stuff that I'm going to keep saying stuff a lot. Just more on the interpersonal relationships. We go from sex to relationships, which is like, yeah, cool. So next time, also you'll notice I'm breaking these ones up into tiny chunks as much as I can. There's lots of like there's lots of easy breaks in the Freudian one because it's kind of like vignettes and snapshots. So I'm able to break them up pretty nicely. So next time we're going to talk about inferiority and compensation, as well as feminine psychology. I bundled these two together just because of space. They're really two independent chunks, but and both can be crawled into in way more detail. But as you figured out, the lectures are kind of a broad overview to give you a good sense of what's going on, while the textbook goes into the super fine detail. That's it. I have a meeting in 2 minutes, so this is good timing. Thanks for watching and hanging in there. We're in the final stretches in these super weird times. So, bye!